Hi, everybody. I had a couple extra minutes for lunch. I think we're still on schedule, so appreciate everybody's running out, grabbing food, and coming back. Hope everybody enjoyed lunch. The rest of the afternoon's basically in the program. We're going to hear from Sherry Chapman and Tim Hollister in a minute, and then we're going to start workshops for a little over an hour. Then we're going to come back and do a little bit of discussion on them. And then actually in our property lab or our auto lab, we have the driving simulators that you've heard about, which we're very excited about. So again, still a lot to do, a lot more to discuss. And I know part of what all of you wanted to be able to do was have discussions. And that's why we kind of approached it with the breakout themes. Continuing with our, level setting information, we wanted to have Sherry Chapman come up and talk about, her perspectives on teen driving and safe driving. Sherry?
Thank you, Henry. In this presentation, we will discuss the impact model of engaging teenagers in safe teen driving. Most of you know something about IMPACT. For those of you who don't, IMPACT is an acronym for Morning Parents Act. We are a 501c3 nonprofit organization run solely by volunteers. IMPACT was formed by the families of three teens who were killed in separate car crashes in Connecticut within an 11-day period in a 25-mile radius of one another in December of 2002. Since that time, our membership has grown. Members of IMPACT have either lost teenage family members or friends in motor vehicle crashes or are survivors of crashes involving teen drivers. Our mission is to eliminate tragedies caused by inexperienced drivers through awareness, education, and legislation. Our programs include a billboard awareness program. You'll see some examples of those on the walls. We also work closely with state and federal agencies and legislators to advance legislation that protects teen drivers, their passengers, and all of us who share the roads with them. Our primary educational effort is delivered through our Drive for Tomorrow program. We offer that at high schools, driving schools, hospitals, church groups, and other forums. Our audience is largely comprised of teenagers and sometimes combined teen parent groups. There is no charge to high schools. We're supported by grant money and public donations alone. IMPACT's Drive for Tomorrow program is 60 to 90 minutes in length, depending on whether we have one or two speakers. You can see on the screen that there are three components to our program, and each is integral to the other. It starts with one or two IMPACT speakers who share their personal experience involving a teen driving tragedy. And I would like to emphasize that we share, we do not preach. We're very personal with the audience. The talk is followed by a video relating to the story that the students have just heard about. Typically, it will be a memorial video, but that's not always the case, such as when the IMPACT speaker is an offender or a victim. Following the video, the teens are ready to learn about the shocking statistics, risk factors, what happens to the body in a crash, what the state is doing to protect them, and what they can do to protect themselves and their friends. Let's take a closer look at each of these components. These are some of our program presenters. I'll introduce them very briefly, and I don't have my laser with me, so I'll start from the top left. Nicole was seriously injured in a crash involving a teen driver when she was in high school. She suffered a traumatic brain injury. Janice lost her only child in a crash that also took the lives of three of his classmates and a young father and husband. Jim and Pam lost their son in a motorcycle versus car crash. The car was driven by a 17-year-old. Linda lost her 15-year-old son in a crash. Her older teenage son was driving. That is why we have the restriction on sibling passengers. Dave's 17-year-old daughter perished. I'm moving down to the bottom left. Dave's 17-year-old daughter perished along with three other teens in Bristol. Above him, David was driving when he crashed, killing his then-girlfriend's younger brother on his birthday and seriously injuring another brother. Donna lost both her 17-year-old son and 14-year-old daughter in the same crash that also took the life of her daughter's friend. And that is why we have a restriction on sibling passengers. Jane's teenage daughter was killed in a single vehicle crash. Taylor's good friend Jessica was killed. And my son, Ryan, was riding as a passenger in a car driven by a teen when it crashed in Hebron, Connecticut. The common denominator in all these crashes, speeding and inexperience. Some of the crashes involved alcohol, multiple teen passengers, and other distractions. These are the children of our extended impact family. We display posters of them in our Drive for Tomorrow programs. I will show you a few short clips of my son's memorial video to give you a sense of the format of our program. Typically, the videos commence early in the child's life and include music meaningful to the family and audience. We try not to replicate the music in any of the videos. Often we will include home movies, and in my case, I saved all of my kids' notes to me, so I included some of them. I also wrote a poem about Ryan that spans the length of the video. You'll see some portions of the poem on a number of the following slides. We want to show that our kids grew up just like other kids. Most of our impact children were honor students, played sports, went on vacation, and loved their families. They never expected to die the way they did.
Far away from where you are, these miles have torn us worlds apart. times I miss you. Yeah, I miss you. So far away from where you are, I'm standing underneath the stars, and I wish you were here. I miss the years that were erased. I miss the way the sunshine would light up your face. I miss all the little things. I never thought that they'd mean everything to me. Yeah, I miss you. Wouldn't I wish you were here? I feel the beating of your heart.
At the end of the video, there may be images of the vehicle, news accounts of the crash, scenes from the cemetery, the monument, the cross, all depending on the situation. I'll spare you this, but it does show the audience the abrupt transition between life and death, from being a happy, healthy, carefree kid to the violence of a crash to death. After the audience has heard our personal story and seen the video, they're ready to listen to the facts and statistics. This is where the substantive portion of the program begins. I like to say that we get into the kids' heads through their hearts. We work hard to convey information to them in a relatable way. For instance, when we talk about statistics, we don't just tell them how many teens die in a crash each year. We ask them to imagine a 747 jet filled to capacity with teenagers crashing 10 times a year in the United States, killing all on board. Now, the horror of that image is something that a teenager can relate to. We cover all of the risk factors, but also stress that seemingly innocent behavior can be extremely risky. We are increasingly concerned with distracted driving and emerging technologies that foster inattention behind the wheel. We talk about the violence of car crashes. We describe in detail the three impacts: the car crashes into whatever it crashes into, and it comes to a halt. The people in the vehicle, still traveling at that same rate of speed, slam into whatever they slam into. It might be the dashboard, other passengers, a steering wheel. Hopefully everyone is wearing a seatbelt, or there may be yet another impact as their body exits the vehicle and lands wherever it lands. We talk about unbelted backseat passengers as projectiles, causing the impact up front to be all that much more severe. And then we talk about the third impact. After the body comes to a stop, often the vital organs are still traveling at that same rate of speed. They smash into other body parts. The brain hits the skull. The lungs hit the ribs. The heart hits the sternum. Sometimes organs become detached. Blunt force trauma. This is how the majority of our children died. At this point in the program, no one in the audience wants to die this way. We stress that these deaths are preventable. Our discussion on what the state is doing to protect teens is essentially a discussion of the graduated licensing laws. Towards the conclusion of our Drive for Tomorrow program, we ask the kids to take some concrete steps to protect themselves and their friends. We urge them to make a commitment that they will not engage in driving or riding behavior that will put themselves or their friends at risk. That if they feel uncomfortable in a vehicle, they are empowered to speak up. We ask them to enter into a friend-to-friend pledge so that friends are empowering friends. Lastly, we give them ways to get out of an unsafe vehicle driven by someone who won't listen. One example is to feign sickness, a stomach ailment to be more specific. Tell them to pull over, you're sick, you're going to throw up. No one wants you to vomit in their vehicle. Our audiences are always attentive. We solicit written feedback from students so that we can continually gauge the effectiveness of our program. I'd like to share a few of the student comments. This program was the most influential presentation that I or the school has seen. I drove much slower yesterday and this morning. Today I wore my seatbelt. Yesterday I didn't. Thanks. It made me realize how much of an impact my actions can have on my parents. It definitely made me appreciate them and their decisions more. It was really sad, but that's what made everyone start thinking about their lives and the people they love and who love them. Your program was amazing. It should be nationwide. I haven't sped since the program. You are all some of the bravest people I have ever seen in my life. So thank you very much. If you're interested in learning more, I'd be happy to talk to you. Also, we have another Impact member, Mary, raise your hand, who would be happy to speak with you as well. Thank you so much for having me today.
Well, let me say first that it's an honor to share the podium with one of my heroes and mentors, Sherry Chapman. If you've never been to an Impact presentation and you haven't seen 600 teenagers, I mean, Sherry undersells it when she says they pay attention. I mean, you could hear a pin drop in those auditoriums, and I think it's because they're confronting their mortality for the first time, but Sherry and her team are just, their effectiveness is almost hard to describe. Since June of last year, I have been honored to be invited to conduct the first half hour of the two-hour required parent-teen safety class at two driving schools, the Avon Driving School and AAA West Hartford, and Angela Brooks from Avon is here, and Steve Rourke from AAA is here, and I think it's been a well-received program. Typically, we have about 25 to 40 parents and their teens, and I should digress for a moment. When I talk other places in the country, and I talk about Connecticut's two-hour parent class, they say, you do what? I was in Missouri in September. Missouri is a very interesting parallel. Twice the population of Connecticut, but six times the crash rate among teens, which because they have a very weak GDL. It's a good example of the effectiveness of our GDL. But anyway, when I make this presentation, I tell parents the essential points from my blog and from my book and what they need to know about parenting teen drivers. And as I think many of you know and you'll hear, my focus is not about how to drive a car. It's about what I always say, it's those 10 minutes before the teen gets behind the wheel. That's what parenting is, and that is my focus. So what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna take a few minutes and just tell you what I tell the parents when I do this this teen driving class. So I start with my parenting of my son, Reed. This is actually one of the pictures that you saw in Sherry's panel of children, and I make the point that he drove crash-free for the 11 months that he had a license, and as he did, my wife and I gave him more and more time, freedom out on the road. I talk about that during that time, I considered myself to be a responsible, hands-on, well-informed parent of a teen driver. And then I tell them that I assumed during this time that the state legislators and the driving schools and the DMV and law enforcement had all gotten together and had figured out that as long as you had a road test and a written test and had taken driver's ed, that you were good to go, you were gonna drive, you were safe enough that the state of Connecticut would issue you a driver's license. So then I talk about the night of Reed's crash, and again, many of you have heard my presentations, but he crashed at the intersection of where 84 becomes 72 on 84 East in Plainville, and so I'm not gonna go into all the details, but he was on an unauthorized joyride with teen passengers at night, and he died, and here's the Sherry Chapman echo, of speed and inexperience with how to handle a skid no alcohol, no drugs, no cell phone. So he died of the, go back to what Kevin Borup said this morning about the things that need more emphasis in the class. His crash was a perfect example. So then I transitioned to one of my mantras, which is the teen driving is everybody's problem. And this is more of a point maybe for, you know, people without teen drivers, but I point out that there are 3 million new drivers every year in the United States, about 25,000 here in Connecticut. Their crash rates are three, as you heard from Neil, are 3 to 4 times the rate of the safest group. But then I point out, and Sherry also alluded to this, that teen drivers kill and injure more others, passengers in their own cars, other drivers, passengers in other cars, and pedestrians, than they do themselves. So, you know, seatbelts, you're talking about your own safety. Teen driving, you're talking about the safety of everybody on the road. So next, I try to convey a key point about GDLs, one I don't think we've actually heard about so far today, by showing them emails that we actually received when we were serving on the task force in 2008. I'll just read the second one. I always refer to as my favorite. The fact is that our children have to grow up, and to do that, they have to make mistakes, and some of those mistakes will be fatal. A parent actually wrote that, and the impact on the task force was we need to change our teen driver laws very quickly. But the point I make to parents is that one of the key purposes of the teen driver laws is to take parents off the hook, to make them understand that the most dangerous situations should not be a negotiation between parent and teen. Honey, I would love to let you go to the movies and come back with 3 of your friends after midnight, but it's against the law. So parents, you know, they see the inconvenience of the GDL laws, but they don't see the benefits, and I try to make that point through this video, through the email. So then I turn to what really is my mantra, especially in my book, is there's no such thing as a safe teen driver. And I apologize to the teens. I said, this has nothing to do with your intellect or your character or your public service or anything. But I said, but there are some biological facts that you and your parents need to know about. And I talk about the delayed development of the human brain, the fact that it takes years to get comfortable with the idea of not looking at the perimeter of the car, but looking down the road at the developing traffic situation, which is how you avoid a crash. And then I talk about really the limits of driver education. It's essential, but we can't train our teens through driver's ed with any large percentage of the situations they will be facing when they become licensed drivers. I always say we train our teens in, you know, Ford Taurus on local streets, and then they drive an SUV on the Mass Pike into Boston at rush hour. You just can't prepare them for that. So I make the point that there are no shortcuts, and safe teen driving takes years. Then I talk about parent attitudes, and my advice, just to implant a vision, is act like an air traffic controller. Every time the new teen driver gets behind the wheel, you go through the safety checklist just the way an air traffic controller would do with a pilot, and the car doesn't leave the driveway until the air traffic controller gives the all clear. Then I talk about what I call the driver's ed paradox, and believe me, let me say, take a moment to say that there are Connecticut driving schools in the room who have just, all of you have been just incredibly supportive of my work, and I'm extremely grateful to that, and I'm grateful for the partnerships that I've developed with several of the driving schools, and I always make the point that driver's ed is absolutely essential. It would be nice if our teens could take 6 months or even a year of driver education, but you know the financial realities are otherwise. But teens need to know the rules of the road and how to drive the car, but we should not assume, parents should not assume, and driving schools should not, you know, convey the idea that someone who finishes driver's ed is a safe driver. The message is that they are a beginner at a dangerous activity, and the learning and the supervision goes on after that. Next perspective, I talk about risk factors. I say that statistically, the chance of a teen driver getting in a fatal crash is about 1 in 4,300, and the risk of a serious injury is about 1 in 30. So then I talk about the factors that so-called spike the punch bowl and elevate those average risks into something approaching a crash about to happen. And I use this slide in two ways. I talk about my son's crash where he had several of these factors, including night driving and speeding and passengers and joyriding all working together to raise those statistical probabilities. And then I also use this to emphasize fatigue. I tell parents fatigue is the hardest thing for you to monitor because it can change from day to day. It can change in the course of a day. If your teen is out, up all night writing a paper, or a lock-in activity at a community event, do you really want them driving to school or anywhere else the next day? Then I segue to purposeful versus recreational driving and tell parents about the aha moment that I had when I served on the task force. Oh, really? There's a difference between purposeful and recreational driving, or so-called joyriding, and I try to make the point that joyriding, teens on the road for fun, is the major danger because that's where we see the distraction, the risk-taking, and the peer pressure. With regard to passengers, I tell the parents this is the most misunderstood and widely ignored danger. Having your teen drive other teens, or having your teen be a passenger with another teen driver, is convenient. But I take my the great quote from our friend Dave Preusser, Neil's colleague: don't put your convenience ahead of your teen driver's safety. Some of you may have heard about the crash in Louisiana about 6 weeks ago. Family of eight on its way from East Texas to Disney World, 10:30 at night, 16-year-old driver at the wheel. Mother, father, and four kids in the back, unbelted. At 10:30 at night, the teen driver fell asleep at the wheel, crossed into the other lane. Everybody died except the driver and his brother. All of the six who died, mother, father, and four kids, were unbelted, putting all your most precious cargo in the hands of your least experienced driver. Now, I also tell parents, don't let the fact that our teen driver laws allow siblings to be driven after 6 months give you the impression that siblings are better passengers or safer passengers. The sibling difference is just a good example of pushback from parents for the purpose of convenience. And so that leads to also to what Dave Preusser very eloquently said about precious cargo. I then talk about alcohol, which is not really my area of expertise. I simply point out that one-third of teen driver fatalities nationally are alcohol-related. I refer them to the two great programs, MADS, Power of Parents, and the Foundation for Advancing Alcohol Responsibilities, I Know Everything program. I talk about the most dangerous times. The parents can figure out that late night and Saturday and Friday are dangerous times, but I talk about the immediately after school. Sherry talked about Donna Jenner. The 17-year-old was killed with his 15-year-old sister and a 14-year-old friend. They were leaving a school that had let out early, and I think they were on their way to fast food or someplace. It was a sort of a joyride after school. The hours after school are when we most see violations of the passenger laws and joyriding. And then I talk about summer. 60% of the crashes occur from May to August because that's when we get the joyriding. Texting and cell phones, I try to go quickly past the obvious of texting being blindfolded, but I try to emphasize the newest research in the last 12 months that says that obviously texting is eyes off the road and mind off the situation, but we know the average text message takes about 5 seconds. And the newest research says that it's not as though you finish a text message and you look back at the road and you immediately know exactly what's going on. It takes a couple of seconds to regain what's called situational awareness. So I try to make the point that texting, a single text message, is on the order of 10 seconds of distraction. And I say, now don't go out and close your eyes for 10 seconds while you're driving, but count to 10 and see all the things that you will miss when your teen is sending a text message. I tell parents, easier to say than it is to do, for cell phones, the best practice is zero tolerance. The cell phone goes in the glove box before the car is turned on, and it stays there until the car is turned off. I am frankly, and I've said this many times on my blog, I'm not a big fan of the apps that claim to disable texting while driving. I think if the phone is right there in the cradle, it's a distraction and a nuisance. Then I say that it's not just cell phones. These are increasingly large, complicated dashboard-mounted screens with interactive controls and internet connections. I won't name the manufacturer, but there's one where you can actually load the family photo album onto your screen in your car. So the distraction, and Sherry mentioned, is increasing, and it has nothing to do with cell phones. I encourage in a teen driver agreement, which I'll come back to, a broad ban on any electronic device that is not part of safe driving. Then I sort of try to go beyond texting and make the point that multitasking is a myth. It's a zero-sum game. If we're distracted, that takes away from safe driving. I talk about the newer research that hands-free and voice-activated is also distracting. I make the point that GPSs are legal for teens, even 16 and 17-year-olds, because they are navigation devices. But I worry about when the Garmin or the TomTom or whatever the manufacturer is says, turn left here, that the new driver processes that, oh, it must be safe to turn left here. The machine just told me so. I make the point that headphones are bad because hearing is part of your safety equipment when you're driving. And here I most try to make the point to parents that you, when it comes to electronic devices, you are the role model. If you're ordering movie tickets on your screen while you're driving, you're going to have a hard time telling your teen not to text because you're doing sort of the same thing. Seatbelts, should be the no-brainer. I think the parents are shocked when they see that 50% of the teen driver fatalities are unbelted, and I just say this should be an absolute no-brainer rule. Every teen driver, every passenger belted, no exceptions. This morning, Gary mentioned my pet peeve, and let me just take a moment to explain what this is. Most high schools in the summer send out a request to parents saying, asking for three types of permission. My teen can drive him or herself to and from school, my teen can drive other students to and from school events, and my teen can be a passenger of other student drivers to and from school events. So I try to make the point that these forms are a trap for the unwary because they put teen drivers and teen passengers together, and they imply that the passenger laws don't apply to school events, which they clearly do. The good news is that through the great work that Gary has done with the students from Glastonbury, there is now attention to this at the state level, and we're hoping that we get a better revision of these forms in the future. I'm a big fan of teen driving agreements. Clear rules are essential. Connecticut DMV has an excellent model right on its website. I would love to get Connecticut to the point where teen and parent have to turn in a signed agreement when they apply for the license. That's been talked about. So I finish with, parents come to me and say, okay, I looked at your blog, I looked at your book, where do I start? So I try to give them a simple formula, PACTS, the five biggest dangers in teen driving, and I say, look, if you address these, not that you're going to have a safe driver, but at least you're going to have your priorities in the right place. So passengers, alcohol, curfews, meaning night driving, texting, and seatbelts, PACTS, a nice, simple formula to remember. So that's what I tell the parents in about, I've given you the shorter version because you're obviously the sophisticated audience. I think what I'm most proud of is that I'm able to deliver this as a parent to parent, which I think is effective. I think my list is a little bit different than a lot of the literature that's out there. And then of course, what my frustration and what keeps me awake at night is that in 6 months through Avon and AAA, I guess I've talked to maybe 600-700 parents, but there's 25,000 new teen driver families every year in the state of Connecticut, and we've sold 8,000 books. My publisher's ecstatic, but there are 13 million teen drivers out there. So there's clearly a lot of work to do. And by the way, Gary, Commissioner Ayala mentioned this morning that some of you know, I'm very glad to say that my book is going to be translated into Spanish by my publisher in the fall of 2015. They actually started the laborious process of dialectically appropriate translation, but I'd be very grateful to any of you who have ideas on how we can market this product. And remember, the proceeds of the book don't go in my pocket, they go to my son's memorial fund, which is doing some very wonderful things. But if you have ideas as to how we can get the word out, in coordination with the Drive Only program and the licensing undocumented residents, I'd be very grateful. So let me finish with this one sort of off-topic remark. I was listening to Neil this morning, and the statistics and the progress that we've made are great. And here's what else is keeping me up at night. I was in Nevada 3 days ago at a conference, and I paid $1.89 for gas. And what are we paying here in Connecticut? $2.20, somewhere in that range. And summer will be here in 5 months. is the better economy and $2 a gallon gas going to undo some or all the progress that we've made? Think about it. Thank you.
Thank you, Sherry and Tim. I think, you know, when we were really talking about this, it was about level set on the information that you needed, and then this was a level set on kind of the emotional cost of what we're talking about. So I thought it was that was great. So again, thank you very much for that. So again, we talked about having a dialogue and having discussion, and we'd like to move to the workshop piece of this day. In about 10 minutes, we'd like to kick off 5 different workshops. On your name tag, it actually has a room. If you don't know what room you're in, I'm going to tell you in a second where to go for those rooms. So we're going to start with real simple, this staying in this room. And we're not going to pull the wall down. We're just going to have it on either side. It's a big room and should be fine for that. The how can we work, for purposes of this number 2 breakout, how can we work with the law enforcement to improve teen driver safety? I'm going to make it auditorium right. So my left, your right, auditorium right. And the purpose is number 5, how can we improve parent education and community outreach? This is auditorium left, so your left, okay? So how can we improve parent education and community outreach? So now the other rooms, that's pretty easy. So if you have either auditorium left or right on your name badge, then you're probably pretty good. Now it gets a little more complicated, and so we'll have people outside to help you through this, but I'm going to give you some, I think, fairly easy directions. So how can we collaborate to improve teen driver laws? That's in 4B, classroom 4B. I'm going to tell you where that is in a second. 4A is right attached to it, and 3 is right across. So we're going to walk past classrooms 3, 4A, and 4B. The very simple directions is everybody came in a front door and you kind of wound back here past the cafeteria, you're going to go straight back out as if you were going back out the main door. And instead of going right to go out the door, you're going to go left. And when you go left, you're going to go down past a winding hall. You're going to be looking for classroom 3, 4A, and 4B. I am actually going to be in one of the breakouts. Which one am I in? 4A. And so I will be leading a group there, and we also have other people outside to get you to the right classrooms. The format of this will be, we'll have facilitators. The facilitators will have some topic starting discussion items. And then we're hoping to really just really get more dialogue going in each of the breakouts. At 2:45, we'll end those workshops. We'll all come back to this room and we'll have some dialogue for about an hour on each of those breakouts as we're trying to coalesce some of the information. Obviously, it won't be the final word. We'll have more stuff to do, but this was the idea was to share some of what comes out of the breakouts. And then at 4 o'clock, we're going to have the opportunity, anybody that wants to see the Save a Life Tour and see the simulated driving, you can do that in the auto lab, which is over there. I know there's probably a lot of questions. You can grab me right now, and then we have people outside again. This is auditorium right, this is auditorium left, and we're going straight out and to the left for the other classrooms. Okay? Thank you so much. See you at 3 o'clock.